food itself actually has one of the largest impacts on biodiversity globally. The key is to find the most sustainable way to produce food, and seafood is no exception.
Around the world, there were concerns with the ratio of bycatch to prawn catch, and that potentially there was a high volume of bycatch being caught as there were to prawn catch. Something had to be done.
It's our kids' livelihoods. If we kept going the way we were going, there wouldn't be much left for them.
Well, a lot of this started from the original turtle excluder device because there were concerns with the interaction of trawl vessels with sea turtles.
What's this, Mick? The 12-fathom net? This is your what we call the turtle excluder, so it's just an aluminium grid. So all the product comes through the net. Anything too big to go through the grill here will come out through this escape hatch here. Any, you know, big fish, sharks, rays, turtles.
I mean, some crew, you know, never see these animals anymore. But, you know, before TEDS, they were common, and they were also dangerous to crew.
So it's a massive difference. It's almost like two different trawl fisheries, really.
You know, over the years, we've, you know, refined them, we've made them bigger, and now, to be honest, we couldn't live without them. They're awesome.
So while grids are able to remove large animals from going down into the trawl net, new innovation is required to remove the small fish that would otherwise go through the grid and straight into the cod end.
We saw a process where new designs and new methods were coming up, and then they became iterative, and to the point where basically they went to industry. And Northern Prawn Fisher was a great example where they actually had a trial of an industry-based program for bycatch reduction.
The industry of the Northern Prawn decided it wanted to do something about the bycatch, more than what was already happening. So industry agreed that a 30% reduction was a good target.
At the time, 30% I think was a stretch. It sounded like a stretch.
I don't think we quite realised the struggle that we might have had to get it done.
The Tom's Fisheye is shaped like a, you could call it a squashed cone. When it goes through the water, creates a bit of a turbulence back behind it.
And the fish are attracted to that. Once they get into that vortex of the cone, they're inclined to then escape through the top.
On the vessels, AFMA were quoting 40, 45%, which, you know, we think, well, that's a lot. But when we got the data, analyse it, it turned out to 40, yeah, I think it was 44, 45% plus no prawn loss.
When you're used to your nets being a certain size in the tiger fishery, to then have them come up and they're half the size. The prawns are all there, but the fish are getting out.
Generally, it takes years to get these things in, but with results as good as 44, 45% of bycatch reduction, fishermen are excited to use them straight away.
Australian fishermen started that because we got out there and decided to, hey, we have to save something.
We're seeing a lot of the industry's members from all around Australia starting to look at it and thinking, you know, this is something we want to try. So I think that's one that's becoming quite exciting.
So we got some local marine scale species that have been under a bit of pressure. And while we have a very, very minimal interaction with them, we want to be proactive in seeing if we can reduce that even further. Like prawns, we want our kids to be able to catch these species as well. The Northern Prawn Fishery had shown some pretty significant results in using this fisheye. We thought if it works up there, it should work down here.
Yeah, I think it's great to see an industry-based innovation in bycatch reduction start going viral, if you like, around the industry. It's fantastic.
Fishing is not an industry where you get to put your name up in lights, so to speak. It's more of an industry where you just go and do what you need to do and not expect a big reward or or anything for that matter. And that's why I suggested we name it after Dad, because it's something that our family has been doing since 1968. So I just thought that Dad, God rest his soul, is probably up there looking down thinking, no, there you go.
One thing I have found in talking with colleagues from around the world, they are often amazed at the close working relationship between the science and the industry. Sometimes they find it incredibly difficult to fathom. It's like, well, what do you mean you're working with the industry? You know, how can you get the industry to work with you? You know, why do they trust the science? And I think it's really important to have that trust, to build those partnerships, because there's always the theory, but then you have to put it into practice.
I mean, WWF's mission is about preserving biodiversity, really in partnership with people.
The work that we're doing, CSIRO and industry, as a partnership, I think that's paramount to a healthy fishery, both ecologically and socially.
Working bycatch mitigation is definitely not a static thing, and I think there's some really exciting things we could do into the future. I mean, we've seen some initial work happening with LED lights, some working with different levels of lighting and different colours. I think it's a really fascinating area.
We're always striving to make our fishery better, and we have a social obligation to do that.
I don't think it's an end point. I don't think they'll ever get to a stage where they'll think, you know, that we've done enough, unless they get rid of all bycatch.
The MPF's always been in pursuit of being the best it can be.
Even once you've got marine stewardship certification, that doesn't mean you stop trying to be sustainable. Actually, it's an ongoing journey.
From where we were 3-4 years ago to what we've got now, that's pretty amazing.